welcome to the Lawrence Davenport Show. And our guest today is Tom Pawkins, former direct chairman of the Republican Party of Texas, former chairman of the Workforce Commission of Texas and is presently a commissioner, and former director of ACTION, the National Volunteer Agency. Tom has written a very interesting book, Bringing America Home. And he's going to talk to us about that. And one of the chapters that I want to make sure that Tom talks to us about is the bubble economy, the destruction of the middle class. Tom, welcome to the show.
All right, good to be with you.
Can you tell us what you mean when you talk about the destruction of the middle class?
Well, what I talk about in the book, Bringing America Home, is how America lost her way in the post-Reagan period of American politics. And that's the first half of the book. The second half of the book is what we do to put the pieces back together again. And one of the areas that I've been particularly concerned about is the loss of our manufacturing sector in the United States. It was once, clearly, the U.S. was once clear the most powerful manufacturing country in the world. And we're slipping rather dramatically on that front. So many of American jobs have been shipped overseas, outsourced, or simply gone away in the manufacturing sector over the last decade. In fact, from 2000 through 2010, we lost one-third of our U.S. manufacturing jobs. And that's about 5.5 million jobs that just went away. And quite frankly, I don't think you can have a strong economy without a strong manufacturing base. And so we've shifted more from a productive economy with emphasis on providing products. We once, when I was growing up, were proud to say it was made in Texas or made in the USA, and very little is made in the USA even more today. And so what I talk about is how we've got a national tax policy which rewards the financial engineers because debt is fully deductible, while savings, capital investment, and employment, which are the engines of private sector job creation, are punitively taxed. I mean, we have the most onerous corporate tax system in America, I mean, in the world, a 35% corporate tax rate, a 7.65 employer portion of the payroll tax, and literally we have a tax policy that exports prosperity and American jobs overseas. And what I have called for is to really get away from an economy driven by the Wall Street private equity moguls and financial engineers, and one driven more by Main Street producers and small businessmen and women who really grew the private sector in our society. And the best way to do that, I argue, is by replacing this onerous corporate tax system with a 8% border-adjusted consumption tax, which really would reward investing in America and bringing jobs home to America. An example I've used is a U.S.-made Cadillac shipped to Germany, and it's not just the Mexicos and the Chinas of the world because of their low-wage structure that have gained manufacturing expertise at our expense. Germany still maintains a strong manufacturing sector, but you take a U.S.-made Cadillac, you ship it to Germany to compete against a European-made Mercedes-Benz, and you're hit at the German border with a 19% border-adjusted consumption tax. So hypothetically, if you're trying to sell that U.S.-made vehicle at $50,000, you're at a 19% disadvantage trying to compete in Germany. The Mercedes-Benz coming into the U.S. doesn't have to pay our corporate taxes or our employer portion of the payroll tax. We have no border-adjusted consumption tax here in the U.S., and so not only that, but they get a tax credit on their business consumption tax back home in Germany. So we're at a 19% disadvantage with Germany. The EU nations have a 20.77 trade advantage over us on all exports and imports, and China has a 17% advantage, Mexico a 16% advantage. So I'm calling for leveling the playing field, changing the way we tax business to go more to a business consumption tax and encouraging, if you will, bringing jobs home to America and rebuilding the manufacturing sector, which I think is important not only for a strong economy, but also for national security reasons. And I would add that so many of those good-paying manufacturing jobs that we have lost have been replaced by low-wage service jobs. And so ultimately, as I describe in the bubble economy and the destruction of the middle class, you're getting into a situation in American society in which you're going to have the very rich, the private equity moguls, the Wall Street financial engineers, and then a increasingly shrinking middle class and everybody else. And that's not the kind of society that we grew up in, and I think it's important to begin to reverse that process and bring manufacturing home to America and start rebuilding the private sector. During the first decade of this century, there was zero private sector job creation in this country at the national level. In fact, a loss of private sector jobs. During the 4 years of the Obama administration, there's been very little private sector job creation. The only growth in jobs in the first 10 years of this century was in government jobs, and ultimately I think everybody understands government doesn't create jobs, only the private sector does. And just like in the Reagan administration, Larry, you and I were part of that, the president understood and his advisors understood you had to grow the private sector, and so one of the first things he did was push for bipartisan support to pass the Kemp-Roth Job Creation Act, and our friend, late Congressman Jack Kemp, had a great expression. It was, a rising tide lifts all boats. And he understood that if you could grow the private sector, it would benefit everybody and the entire American economy. And that's what we have to do again, and I think this approach to taxation will help achieve that. And we better do something bold. I'm very frustrated in the post-Reagan period of American politics. It's almost like you've got 40% on one side, beaten up on 40% on the other side, and nobody looking at things from a standpoint of the long-term good of the country and the long-term solutions.
Well, how do you bring people to, you know, we can't say bring them together because that's not going to happen, but how do we have people who begin to put America first?
Well, I have been encouraged. I've done a tremendous number of radio and TV interviews. I've been on a lot of programs, not just conservative talk show hosts. Tom Hartman is a leading liberal talk show host who has a radio and TV show. I've been on his show a number of times. And I've been encouraged that there is a broad consensus, business and labor, conservatives and liberals, that we better do something to bring manufacturing back. And I just think this approach that I've laid out to replace the existing corporate tax structure, which really is, as I said, the most onerous in the world. I mean, we're running manufacturing trade deficits, for example, 2000 to 2008, in excess of $5.5 trillion. I think there's a recognition, particularly on the part of the labor unions. I mean, as these jobs go away, their members disappear. So there's a growing recognition that we're all in this together, and I think that's the approach that has to be taken. And if we do that, I think it can bring together a broad-based coalition, similar to what we were able to do with Kemp-Roth, the Job Creation Act. It had bipartisan support in Congress from Republicans and Democrats alike, and I think we've got to figure out a way how to bring this country together if we're going to get our footing back, so to speak, and begin to get us back on the right track.
But haven't people kind of lost track of what Ronald Reagan used to say? Everybody wants to be Ronald Reagan, but they don't want to follow what Ronald Reagan accomplishes. For example, as you recall, he would always say, don't worry about how it affects you, or worry about how it affects the country, and it'll come out all right on the other end. I'm paraphrasing. For you, it'll come out for your party, it'll come out for everything, if you do what's right for the country.
Well, you're so right, Larry, and let me address that on two fronts. He had a sign on his desk, there's no telling how far you can go if you don't care who gets the credit. And the interesting thing, and I guess I didn't appreciate it as much when I was younger at the time as I do now, having seen so many politicians, Republicans and Democrats since then, President Reagan was a very humble man. He didn't have a big ego. He was willing to have people around him who had differences of opinion on a number of issues. He was open to that, and also people, he's not afraid to have people as smart as or smarter than he was, although I always thought his intelligence was underestimated by the mainstream media, which didn't like a lot of his views, but underestimated how really intelligent Ronald Reagan was. But I would simply say that on that front, you've got to do a couple of things, and the president brought a lot of us, Larry, from around the country, kind of outsiders to Washington. He used the term to drain the swamps, and he was willing to encourage us to make decisions based on what the long-term good was. And the difference between a lot of people who claim to be conservatives today and what we did back then is, you know, we were against many of the failed policies of the Carter administration, but we at the same time had common sense, conservative-based solutions to the problems. If something that we didn't like, we didn't think was working in the Carter administration, rather than just bitch and moan about it, we came up with alternative approaches. I mean, if that little agency that you and I were involved in, Action, which is now called AmeriCorps, I mean, we really emphasized the social entrepreneurs and encouraged people who were doing good work to replicate that in different places in the country. We literally were able to do more with less money. And across the board, there was this mindset. I remember in 1982 when President Reagan stuck with Paul Volcker. We had high interest rates and a lot of people unhappy, and the president was told it was going to hurt him in the elections to stick with Volcker. But he thought it was the right thing to do, and he did it. And, you know, we paid a price in 82, but from the long-term economic growth of the country, it was the right thing to do. And I think you just have too much influence by these high-paid political consultants, whether it's the David Axelrod on the Democratic side or the Karl Rove's on the Republican side. And these are people who look at the polls and often savage the opponent. They're very good at that, but they're really not very good at developing long-term policies for the good of the country. And those kind of people really didn't have much influence with Ronald Reagan. He looked at it from the standpoint of policy considerations and, again, was willing to hear different points of view before moving forward. He wasn't perfect, but quite frankly, it was a good model that could be replicated today. Our problems are different today, but that model worked effectively, and we really haven't had a model, whether it's been a Republican-elected president or a Democrat-elected president since then, that's worked very effectively for the country.
Well, you know, again, Tom, they're talking about bringing the country to another financial crisis, which is really man-made decisions for a crisis. We have the wealth within the country to solve our own problems. People keep talking about Europe has the wealth to solve their problems. We have the wealth to solve ours, but do we have the political will?
Well, I think the people are ahead of the leaders, and that's one of the arguments of the book. I mean, I'm one who believes that these financial institutions have just gotten too big, and I agree with Thomas Honing, who previously was head of the Kansas City Fed and is now I think the number two official at FDIC, who said if they're too big to fail, they're too big. And I think that we've allowed these Wall Street financial institutions to accumulate too much economic power in our society, and banks ought to be involved in the banking business and not get into a lot of this risky credit derivative business. And as I talk about in the book, I mean, you had a situation in which Bill Clinton had the Secretary of the Treasury, Robert Rubin, who came from Goldman Sachs, and the Wall Street financial institutions got in trouble in the 1990s. And guess what? Rubin bailed them out when they got on the wrong side of the Mexican peso devaluation trade. And then you had Henry Paulson in 2008 and under a Republican president, George W. Bush, who bailed out the too-big-to-fail financial institutions. And again, it was the taxpayers who paid the price for it. And in that case, you had AIG, for example, which is an insurance company, got into the risky credit derivatives trading business. And guess what? They wound up on the wrong side of the trades. Well, then Paulson comes in as Secretary of the Treasury, former Goldman Sachs executive. And by the way, Goldman Sachs had $13 billion at risk there. And they make the credit derivative traders whole. In other words, allow them to get paid 100 cents on the dollar. That was about an $80 billion transfer from the taxpayers to these Wall Street financial institutions. And yet when Enron, which was a Texas company that went busted, it was supposed to, originally an energy company, but it became an energy credit derivatives trading company, when it went busted, The folks on the other side of the trades got about 15 cents on the dollar. When Lehman Brothers went busted in 2008, according to Barron's magazine, they also got about 15 cents on the dollar. So what are we doing bailing out these Wall Street traders for their risky bets? And it's what I call in the book privatization of the gain and socialization of the risk. If the trade works out, they get all of the benefit. If it doesn't, you put it on to the American taxpayer. And I think we've got to end that approach and really end the Wall Street traders and financial institutions' dominance of various administrations, whether Republican administrations or Democratic administrations. You look at the Obama administration, Tim Geithner was a protege of Robert Rubin. Larry Summers, a key figure in the early years in the Obama administration, another protege of Robert Rubin, who then worked for one of those private equity firms and was paid $5 million a year prior to coming back into government for working one day a week. It's nice work if you can get it, but it really doesn't represent the American taxpayer and the concerns of average Americans. And that is what I try to talk about in the book. I remind people of Barry Goldwater, a senator who wrote a book, Conscience of a Conservative, and he said, our goal as conservatives is to represent the forgotten Americans, the middle-class taxpayers who don't have lobbyists in Washington and aren't looking for loopholes in the law. And more and more, the powerful special interests seem to run all too much of government at the national level, and even many of our state governments as well, as I've seen in Austin in the 4 years I've been back in government since being asked by the governor to chair the Texas Workforce Commission.
Well, do you think there's any hope that our legislators will listen to one of the great financiers of our American history, really, who built a lot of these big banks and the financial institutions, Sandy Weill, when he said, they're too big to fail, we need to split them up.
Wasn't that something the other day? Because he's the one that helped engineer getting rid of Glass-Steagall, which separated the banks from their normal commercial banking operations from the risky investment operations and allowed big financial institutions to do both. So that was quite a statement that one of the architects of the change has admitted. It was a mistake, and it's led to very bad consequences. Now, I think that there are a lot of, I see it in Texas, and I see it in Washington. There are a lot of good people who are in the legislature, in our state, a lot of good people who are in Congress. It's an absence of leadership and an absence of people willing to be bold. There's a tendency to trim at the margins or simply, you know, take positions that you know the other side's not going to agree with, as opposed to trying to find some areas where we can work together for the good of the country. And you know, again, back to the Reagan administration, we had a term called the Reagan Democrats, a lot of independent-minded people who liked what the president was saying. And, I mean, if we're focused, for example, on how do we start growing the private sector again, how do we create good jobs for these kids? I mean, you got a lot of kids coming out of college with a four-year degree, on average $25,000 in debt, having a hard time finding work. Meanwhile, people with skills training coming out with a vocational and technical industry certified certificate are able to get good jobs. So there's a lot that I believe is beyond partisanship, and we just allowed ourselves to be trapped in this, our side versus their side, as opposed to addressing common issues. There are going to be some differences, big differences, but there are a number of areas where we can work together, and I think that was one of the strengths of the Reagan administration. I think that's any new administration, whether Republican or Democratic, that wants to make things work has got to try it, and I don't think that happened in the Obama administration. I don't think it happened when George W. Bush was president.
Well, what about, for example, when we were on the Advisory Council on Vocational Education, at that time, we looked around at the various different countries to see how they were providing their training. And I noticed in the editorial that you wrote just recently, you said maybe what we ought to be doing is paying people to get trained, to get educated while they're getting their unemployment, rather than just sending the unemployment check. How would you think that would work? We said it in 1972 or 73, and the country didn't respond to it. Do you think there's any hope that the country would look at it now? Or
Well, let's look at two things. Back in the early 70s, when you and I were both on the National Advisory Council on Vocational Education, where we first met, back then there was a recognition of the value of vocational and technical education. I would argue a greater value than what we've seen recently, a recognition that for many young people, give them the opportunity, if they have the interest and aptitude for it, to go into a vocational and technical education, beginning at the secondary school level. I guess what I was shocked at coming back into government a few years ago was that everybody, you know, the mindset was, well, everybody's going to go to a university. We're going to be part of the knowledge industry. We don't need manufacturing anymore. Those blue-collar skilled trades jobs, those are somehow beneath us. And the irony is they're good-paying jobs. And so I think we've got to do two things. On a more fundamental level, I think we have to get away from pushing everybody to go to a four-year university and viewing kind of an education of one size fits all, recognizing that people have different talents and young people learn differently. There's a craft training center, a marvelous program in Corpus Christi, Texas, that takes a lot of kids who otherwise would be dropouts or throwaways and gives them an opportunity to learn to be welders, electricians, pipe fitters, and get industry certified credential. A lot of those kids, they get in and they suddenly realize as they're working with their hands the importance of basic math, the importance of basic literacy skills. So they do better in academics after they have some career education. So we've got to understand, quit putting everybody in one little box and saying everybody should go to a university, and I think put an increase of an emphasis on vocational and technical education. I mean, look at Tuskegee Institute, where you taught for a number of years and was a vice president. I mean, there's an institution that at one time had the largest number of students in the state of Alabama at a time when it was very segregated. But Booker T. Washington, who wanted to make people self-sufficient and teach people trades and skills in agriculture and in other skilled trades and turn people out who could be economically independent. And I think we've got to get back to the notion of self-sufficiency, and vocational and technical training really can do that. Now, on the unemployment front, all I argue is that if you're going to get extended federal benefits, you should do A, B, or C. Either get a GED if you don't have a high school education, and there's federal funding for that, or get some skills training, and there's federal funding for that as well, or be required to provide some community service for local municipalities or appropriate nonprofits such as Habitat for Humanity. And let's find out who really wants to improve themselves or who is really gaming the unemployment system and treating it more as just another welfare system as opposed to a system to provide insurance while you're looking for work and trying to get back on your feet and get a job.
But how do we kind of wake up America to the fact that, as you said, that everybody's not going to go to college, that vocational technical skills, you know, Sid Marlin, who came up with the term career education, you know, the former superintendent of the schools in Pittsburgh and then became commissioner of education and assistant secretary of education in Washington, and then later on went to head up the college board. And then he was on the board of higher education, and I think that was in Connecticut when he went back home. But how do we get people to have a renewed emphasis on that and don't buy the philosophy that America is going to be the intellectual capital of the world? Because in Russia and China and India, there's lots of people who have the intellectual capital who can work on the computers, you know. And that who bought the, that we're going to be the service industry, that's okay, that we're going to import everything. Because as you know, Tom, if a major conflict happened tomorrow, we would have to import a lot of the material into this country. We don't manufacture it here anymore.
Well, there's a great point by one of the founders of Intel who said, how we're going to out-innovate our competitors. And And his response was, it's hard to innovate if you don't make, because by manufacturing, you learn how to improve your processes and really have the kind of innovation that leads to increased efficiencies and increased value-added products. And if you're exporting that manufacturing, you lose that. And I think it's reversible. I think this is really a good time for U.S. manufacturing to come home. We're seeing some evidence of that here in Texas, which still has the largest private sector job creation of any state in the nation. We've added 1 million jobs over the last decade and a couple hundred thousand just in the past year. But we've had an energy explosion and a real upsurge of natural gas findings here in Texas and elsewhere. And that's a terrific plus for the petrochemical industry. It's not always good for the gas producers, the low price of natural gas, but it sure helps in the petrochemical industry. So we're seeing a real expansion of manufacturing here in the U.S. The key is, in my estimation, you've got supply chain issues, you've got real-time inventory, a number of other factors, which it's advantageous to have your production here. But the problem is, if you've got a tax system that really is so onerous and so encouraging, if you will, to park your money and your manufacturing overseas, that's going to continue to happen. So that's why I think, as I argue in Bringing America Home, that you've got to have a bold approach and change the approach to taxation of business in order to encourage investing in America. For example, all of that money that is parked overseas by multinational companies, by the way, U.S. multinationals over the last decade, they've cut 2.9 million jobs here, and they provide, by the way, 20% of the private sector jobs in this country, while adding 2.5 million overseas. So we need to start reversing that, and that's what a border-adjusted consumption tax would do, because all goods and services coming into the U.S. would have to pay an 8% tax as it comes into the U.S., while all companies exporting from the U.S. would get a tax credit against their business consumption tax here at home. So I think if we can level the playing field with our trading competitors and also provide incentives to bring that money home. For example, my proposal is any company that would bring money home would be allowed to expense it by making capital investments in their business here in the U.S. against the revenues and take that out at an annual basis. So there's a real incentive. You don't have capital investment over 5 or 7 or longer period of time to depreciate. You'd have immediate depreciation in the year in which you made the investment. So it's a real incentive to bring money home to the U.S. So I think there are great opportunities here. It's just an absence of political leadership and will and political courage to make the bold move.
Well, we don't have time to discuss it, but I wanted to give you something that I've been thinking about, and that is in terms of the Federal Reserve, which has done through the crisis, did a lot of things which Federal Reserves, at least people didn't know they had done before, because they also supported a lot of foreign banks in the crisis. It pumped money overseas, but a lot of people didn't realize that was going on, and now they're talking about buying more mortgage securities. And they also are almost right now providing money to banks at almost zero, you know, and I say almost zero. And I'm wondering if instead of buying mortgage securities, if they actually went out and started buying the mortgages, you know, because, for example, if during the crisis, if we went out and bought every mortgage in the country, even at 50%, we would have money left over, you know. And so maybe out and allowed the state and local government to borrow money from the federal government at the rate that we're allowing banks to borrow money from, if they would build highways or roads or bridges, infrastructure, and allow them to get that at the same amount of money we allow the federal banks to receive money, if that would stimulate the economy and get things moving. That's just a thought. And I'm glad to have Tom Pawkins with us, who's author of Bringing America Home. We thank you for listening to us, and have a good day.